So please wait for a few minutes. Once the chief guest speaker will join with us. I am audible. Now, okay, na? I am audible, na? Welcome, sir. Balaji, sir.
Yeah. It's audible.
Yeah.
So sorry for a bit delay.
No, sir. No problem. No, sir. Thank you for joining with us. Thank you for joining with us.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
So, thank you. Very good afternoon, all of you. I am audible, na?
Yeah.
So today with us, Dr. R. Balaji, sir. He is a senior scientist at Center for Fuel Cell Technology, International Advanced Research Center for Powder Metallurgy and New Materials, IIT Madras Research Park. Before introducing our today's speaker, I would like to request our head of department, Dr. S. S. Chaudhary, sir, to please welcome our chief guest. Dr. R. Balaji, sir, virtually.
Thanks, Rajesh. Good afternoon, one and all present here. Good afternoon, Balaji, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
At the outset, I take this opportunity to welcome you all and Dr. Balaji for this student interaction program. I must felt my gratitude to you, sir, that you have accepted our invitation on such short notice and make yourself available for this fruitful interaction. I appeal all the students and my faculty members to take utmost advantage of this today's interaction and webinar of Dr. R. Balaji. Sir, I hand over this session to you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now, before going to start the lecture, I would like to introduce our today's speaker, Dr. R. Balaji, sir. Dr. R. Balaji is presently working as a senior scientist at Center for Fuel Cell Technology, ARCI, Chennai, India. He obtained his PhD from CSIR, Karaikudi, in 2006. He did his postdoctoral work on renewable energy integrated hydrogen energy system at Itami Institute of Technology, Japan, and later on hydrogen generation at ARCI. He has also worked as a scientist in SPIC Science Foundation, Chennai, in the area of hydrogen fuel cells. His research interest includes hydrogen energy technologies, electrochemistry, electrochemical process, electrocatalyst, electroplating, corrosion, water treatment, and currently he is focusing in the area of electrolytic hydrogen generation and PEM, that is polymer electrolyte membrane fuel cell system, and develop PEM based electrolysis system of 2.5 Newton meter cube per hour hydrogen production capacity. So with over a decade of experience in the area of electrochemical hydrogen generation, he has contributed to transfer two technologies to industries. He has published more than 30 papers in journals of repute and filed 4 patents. He received outstanding scientist in the area of hydrogen energy technology from Venus International Foundation in 2016, and is a member of several distinguished professional societies like Society of Advancement of Electrochemical Science Technology, that is SAEST, Hydrogen Association of India, and he is serving as a reviewer in various reputed international journals and has guided about 25 students for their dissertation work, including postgraduate and doctoral students. I welcome you, sir, on
Thank
the
you.
Behalf of Department of Mechanical Engineering, Yashwant Rao Chauhan College of Engineering. I welcome you. And thanks once again for giving your valuable time and sharing your knowledge. So please, sir, Mic is handed over to you, sir. Please, sir. Please start your session.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for your lengthy introductions, and thanks for inviting me to deliver my opinion on hydrogen energy technology. So I think Mr. Rajesh has visited our lab some time back, and he was very into on that particular technology, and he is working on that area. So I'm very happy to hear that news, and today I'm very happy to deliver a lecture on this particular topic. So basically, I'm trying to focus on fundamental aspects, but mostly which we are working on only fundamentals is applied aspects. So I try to cover my lectures, what we carried out in CFC, Center for Fuel Cell Technology, and what would be the way to go forward. So I mean, during my lecture, any point of time, you can stop me and interact with me if you have any questions on that, actually. So once again, I thank for the organizing committee to deliver this lecture on this virtual platform. Sorry for the bit delay in joining with this virtual platform, because the virtual meeting is makes mess more getting time for the meeting and all those things, because we are keeping so many meetings on the virtual platform, so once again it should not get overlap. So that was a few minutes delay in my talk, actually. Yeah, sorry for that. And so I can share my slides right now. Is it okay? Yeah, just for a bandwidth purpose, I am choosing my video off, actually. So that would be fine, I think. Is it okay for you?
Yeah, yeah. As you wish.
Were you able to view my slides?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, good afternoon. Today, I would like to give the overview on hydrogen energy technology. So, if you talk about hydrogen, so we should talk about not only with fuel cell. So, we need to consider other two aspects: how to generate and how to store it before going to use it in fuel cells, actually. So, that two part is also important. If you want to understand the hydrogen energy for a sustainable future. So before going to this topic, a brief introduction about our organization. It's a ARCA, International Advanced Research Center for Powder Metallurgy and New Materials. It's an autonomous R&D institution, comes under Department of Science and Technology. So we headquartered at Hyderabad, and we have two centers at Chennai. So basically it's a material research institutions where we are working on development of materials for various applications, not only in the R&D level. So the ultimate motto of our ARC technology is that whatever the research and R&D activity which you are doing has to be translated as a industrial scale, so that the entrepreneur and it should be transferred to the industry ultimately. So that is the motto of ARCA, and we have about 10 to 11 centers in various field. And in Chennai, we have two centers, one for Center for Fuel Cell Technology, another is Center for Automotive Energy Materials. So it is located at IITM Research Park. And so far, as I said, the translation of research into technology as a commercial viable product. So that is the motto of ARCA. So far, it is transferred about 16 technology to the 28 industry. So this is support CFCT. It was established in 2004, and we have a.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Your screen. Please share the screen, sir.
I'm sharing that now.
No, sir. It is not visible.
Now?
No.
I checked.
Yeah.
just a minute, I am checking it.
Okay.
I am trying to share that, but it is not.
Please take your time. No, sir.
Yeah, present now. I'm doing that. You must grant permission in order to screen share. This means I have given permission already. Just a minute. Now?
No, sir. You can, I think, rejoin again, sir.
Yeah, we'll do that.
Chetan sir.
Yeah, now it's okay.
Yeah, sir. Yeah. Now it is easy. It is easy.
Yeah.
Please, sir.
Yeah. So our Center for Fuel Cell Technology was established in 2004, and so we have about 40 people, ranging from scientists to technical staff and various students. And we have a program for the students. Actually, every year we are recruiting junior research fellows and senior research fellows based on our own interviews and written examinations. If they qualified that, then we will support them for 5 to 6 years for their PhD. So they can register the PhD with any of the NITs and IITs in India. So we have almost MOU with all the IITs and NITs in India. So we will support them for 5 to 6 years till their submission of the PhD. So, and ultimately, I mean, parallelly, they will get exposure to the technology apart from the PhD. So they will actually get exposure to how to develop, how to translate the science into technology. So that is a good opportunity for the youngsters, those who are really interested to do R&D. So we will give full support for the, in terms of remunerations, as well as the, we have very good infrastructures and characterization facilities. State of the art characterization facilities for all the related activities. As I said, the main objective of the Center for Fuel Cell Technology is to develop a PMFC system, which is meant for both for stationary as well as transport applications. So we have demonstrated up to 20 kilowatt capacity for the stationary, and we are using fuel cell as a range extender in addition with a battery. In the electric vehicles, that was also demonstrated. So that was the main objective of the Center for Fuel Cell Technology. And as I said, the if you talk about the hydrogen energy technology, we need to consider before fuel cell, you need to consider two different steps: hydrogen generations, so that also we are taking care, and storage. So we are doing some R&D activities on that aspect also, and ultimately the hydrogen fuel cell technology for the stationary as well as fuels, I mean stationary as well as transport applications. So as I said, this is the energy conversion device. So we have some kind of spin-off technologies, because the materials and the method which we are using for the various technological development can be get into various other spin-off technology like batteries and super capacitors. And So as I said, fuel cell activities, we are not talking about only the fuel cell stack. So we also concentrate on the entire system, because fuel cell require a balance of plants. As you said, various accessories are required if you want to make it a system. So we do concentrate on developing such kind of BOP components, which would be low cost and low power consumption. So that aspects also we are considering, and we are developed up to 20 kilowatt capacity as a system. It's not only a fuel cell, it's a fuel cell system. So it's a kind of plug and play system, so that we demonstrated for various applications. So as I said, the present energy scenario, I don't want to go in deep, because everybody is looking out how to come out from this carbon emissions. So the energy demand is also keep increasing, and as well as the atmospheric CO2 levels also keep increasing. So we need to find out the alternative technology which should not harmful the should not be harmful to the environment, and it should be free from CO2. So that is the main objective of the present energy scenario. And the solution is simple, but that everybody say that we can do electric vehicles and fuel cells, but the implementation will take long time actually. So there are fuel cells, not a new technology, it is 150 years old technology, but still we are trying to make commercialize the fuel cell technology. So we need to go a long way. There are various bottlenecks still, technology challenges are there. So that is the main drive for us to develop a environmentally friendly and affordable fuel cell technology for the need of the world actually. So as I said, it's a basically energy storage medium. So we can store energy in the form of fossil fuels, as we are using petrol, diesels, and batteries. It's an alternative way to store energy. But ultimately, the hydrogen is also equivalent to battery. So hydrogen is not existing in natural as such. So we need to generate hydrogen. So the generation of hydrogen requires energy input. So whatever the renewable energy input which we have has to be stored in the form of batteries or in the form of hydrogen. So we need to use that renewable energy for the generation of hydrogen. So in that case, the hydrogen and batteries both are being considered as energy storage medium. So why hydrogen? So when we have a battery, why do you want to go with hydrogen? Is that the answer is that when you combine with the air, it emits only water. So it will not emit any carbon footprint so into the environment. So that is the main advantage. Apart from that, it has high energy density when compared with any of the batteries. And so it has 142 megajoule per kg of hydrogen, which is high, which will not compare with any of the battery storage medium. And as I said, it can be produced from water. So when you integrate with the renewable energy sources with water, you can get hydrogen without upsetting the environment. And when you do the burning, when you do combustions through electrochemical, especially fuel cell, no carbon containing problems, and it cover any of the vehicles as well as the stationary applications. So as I talk about, so we need to consider two steps before going to fuel cell. One is productions, second storage and utilization. So these three aspects we need to consider if you want to make it fuel cell as a viable product. So currently this hydrogen is being used is not for the energy related applications. It's used to various applications as a chemical, as a fuel, which we are trying to use it. But currently it is being used as a chemical because it's a very good reducing agent. So it has been used for various food grade fertilizer and metallurgy area as a reducing agent. So apart from that, it is also being used as a coolant in nuclear power plant, and because its hydrogen heat carrying capacity is more. So hydrogen is being used as a coolant in various power sectors and nuclear reactors. So apart from this usage of hydrogen as a coolant and chemical, people are trying to use as a fuel using the fuel cell. And so, as I said, when you talk about the hydrogen productions, it is not existing as such in the natural. So it has to be produced in two forms, one from hydrocarbon, one from water. So these are the two major sources for production of hydrogen. So there are various methods for producing hydrogen depending on the feedstock. So as I said, in the, if you see the first column, the natural gas, refinery, LPG, naphtha, kerosene, and methanol, these are all carbon-containing compound. So they can be reformed with steam to get hydrogen. That is called steam reforming. And coal and biomass is another source for hydrogen to get hydrogen by way of gasification. And ammonia, it's a fertilizer based thing. So this ammonia, by cracking ammonia, we can also get hydrogen. And ultimately the water is a carbon-free source. And when you do electrolysis, you can get hydrogen, oxygen without upsetting the environment. And the we can also get hydrogen food and kitchen waste through biological route, but the hydrogen quality from that process is impure. If you compare, if you take all these method, steam reforming, gasification, cracking, biological, all producing hydrogen with impure hydrogen. So we need to adapt some kind of purification steps before going to use it in fuel cell, except this electrolysis process. So why this electrolysis process is more greener? Because though it is a very greener, people are not widely using because of the energy intensive. Because when you want to split the water molecules to get hydrogen and oxygen, so we need to spend a lot of energy to produce hydrogen from the water. So that is why in the worldwide, the production of hydrogen through water electrolysis is 4%. 50% of the hydrogen is being produced from natural gas worldwide. And remaining 50%, about 58%, 48% is coal gasification, about 20%, and partial oxidation, about 30%. So, but when you integrate with this hydrogen from a renewable energy source, so that would be a longer term focus for our R&D peoples. And this is a steam, as I said, I don't want to go in deep into that each and every steps actually. So basically a steam methane reformation is that we are reforming the methane gas with steam at high temperature to produce hydrogen actually. So this is the major method worldwide is being adapted to produce hydrogen. And so that hydrogen, and it requires, as I said, extra purification steps, that is pressure swing adsorption method, which we need to adapt to purify the hydrogen and to get the fuel cell grade hydrogen actually. And we need to use high pressure and high temperature to get the hydrogen from the methane. And so that is a major. And ultimately, as I said, the electrolysis process is the clean and green hydrogen which can obtain. Because if you take power from the PV and do electrolysis, we will get hydrogen and oxygen. So the minimum voltage input to do electrolysis is about 1.5 volt. So in the practical case, we have to apply 2 volt actually, maximum, considering the resistance of the system and electrolyte material. So we need to give high energy to produce hydrogen. So though if you see the energy consumption for the hydrogen production is about 3.5 kilowatt. So if you want to produce 1 meter cube, that is 1000 liter of hydrogen from water, theoretically we have to spend about 3.5 kilowatt hour of power. But in practical case, we will spend about 5 kilowatt practical power to produce 1 meter cube of hydrogen. So if you produce 1 meter cube of hydrogen from the water by spending 5 unit of electricity, how much amount of energy or power we will get it through fuel cell is about hardly 1 nm cube will produce about 1 to 1.2 kilowatt power. So we are spending 5 unit of electricity to produce 1.2 kilowatt of power. So that is the gap is existing. So though the green hydrogen can be produced from electrolysis of water, the energy gap, you need to spend more energy to produce hydrogen from the water. And from the hydrogen, you will get 1 to 1.2 kilowatt of power. So the huge energy requirement is only due to the oxygen evolution, not for the hydrogen evolution.
Sorry for the interruption.
Yeah.
So your slide is not changing, sir. Slide is
now?
Slide number 3 we are seeing. Slide number 3.
3 only, is it?
Yeah. Right from beginning.
Oh.
Now it is changing.
Okay. Now it is changing.
Okay.
Yeah. So this energy, the water electrolysis energy intensive process, the high energy intensive process is because of oxygen evolution, not for hydrogen evolutions, because most of the energy is being used for the oxygen evolution, not for the hydrogen evolutions. So it's a basic electrolysis is basically electrochemical system. You need to have anode, cathode and electrolyte. Depending upon the type of electrolyte which you are using for electrolysis, so it can be categorized acid, alkaline and solid oxide. Acid and alkaline are near ambient temperature operations, and solid oxide electrolysis is high temperature operation, because you need to carry out this oxide ion movement within the electrochemical system only at high temperatures. So if you consider this state of the development for this technology, this alkaline based electrolysis process, it's a well mature technology, and PEM, polymer electrolyte or proton exchange membrane based electrolysis process is also a developed technology, is penetrating right now into the commercial market. And solid oxide electrolysis, it's only a R&D stage, because of the availability of materials to conduct the electrolysis at very high temperature using oxide ion conducting medium. So because of that limitations, it's only R&D level. So when you consider the investing for electrolysis, you have to consider these factors: lower cost and the better purity of hydrogen, and safety and reliability. So these are the main factors. This alkaline electrolysis is a basically water which is being, potassium hydroxide or sodium hydroxide has been dissolved in water. So you need to have an anode and cathode. In this, advantage of this process is that nickel based electrode can be used, so that this cost of the system making cost is very cheap, and you can carry out electrolysis process near ambient condition, and you can get very high pure hydrogen and oxygen. If you do electrolysis, the amount of hydrogen production depends on how much amount of current which you are supplying to the electrolysis cell. So you need to, if you want to more hydrogen, you need to supply more current. So when you apply more current, the electrode should be stable. If the electrode is not stable, so the secondary reactions will take place. It may get dissolved or it may get deteriorated. So instead of hydrogen and oxygen evolutions, the electrode deactivations will take place. So that limit the system life. So that the disadvantage of this process is that this electrode material may not be stable when you apply high current. So that's why if you want to generate more hydrogen, you need to put more number of cells and less current. So that is the disadvantage of this process, though it has advantage of using nickel based electrocatalyst or electrode material. But though it has a low operating current density, what we call it as in technically, depending upon the particular area of the electrode, which you apply current, that is current density. So the, when you operate the system at lower current density, the system will work fine. So these are the various international manufacturers working on developing alkaline based systems internationally. So if you see the energy consumption in all of the process is average, is close to 6 kWh per meter cube. So a normal meter cube. So if you see with that one normal meter cube of hydrogen in fuel cell, hardly we will produce 1 kWh. So spending 7 to 6 unit of electricity and getting 1 unit of electricity is a high energy gap actually. So that is the challenges which are living when you use hydrogen from the water. So as I said, it's a basically electrochemical cell. You need to have anode and cathode. If you see any electrochemical system, the inter-electrode distance between anode and cathode, if it is less, then the electrical resistance for the particular electrochemical cell will come down. So in the case of alkaline, in the case of previous electrolysis process, we are using anode and cathode, nickel based anode, nickel based cathode. In between, you need to have a separator, because the gases which are producing the system is hydrogen and oxygen. If you allow them to combine directly, the explosion will take place. So in order to avoid the mixing of gases, you need to have a separator. So in early case, the asbestos sheet is being used as a separator to separate the produced hydrogen and oxygen. Whereas in the case of polymer electrolyte membrane, the main advantage of this process is that this membrane will act as a separator, which will separate the anode and cathode as well as the hydrogen and oxygen. But at the same time, it also conducts the protons. So that will act as a solid electrolyte. The role of electrolyte in electrochemical system is that the proton, I mean, it should carry the ions or reactant to the respective electrodes. So here the proton is the carrier. So within that polymer matrix, the protons are movable. So that carry the water molecules in the respective electrodes. So that electrodes, that membrane will act as a separator as well as the electrolyte. So you can easily coat any platinum based powder material as an anode and cathode on the two sides of the membrane. So now if you see this, the thickness of the membrane is the only distance existing between anode and cathode in this electrolyte. So that's why you can considerably reduce the inter-electrode distance in electrochemical system that reflect in lower energy consumption and lower operating cell voltage and lower energy consumption for the electrolysis process. So that is the uniqueness of PEM-based system. These are the various components. This is a membrane. Okay. Yeah, so this is the membrane, and these are the two catalysts. As I said, it's a platinum based catalyst, and these slide are the current. Yeah, now is it okay?
Slide is not changing, sir.
Now
we are the same slide number 12.
Is it? Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Now
12 only. Now changing.
Okay.
Now 13.
14.
13.
I change it to 14. I think it takes some time.
Yeah. No, just 13. We seen 13 only. Now 14. Yeah.
I think if you put it in the presentation mode, I think it takes some time.
Yeah. Now it is 15. 15. You can see 15 now.
What about now? I'm discussing about 17.
Okay. Yeah, 17. Yes, sir.
Okay. Is it okay now?
Yeah.
Is it visible now? 17.
Yeah.
Visible. So this is the membrane. Both are anode and cathode, and you need to circulate the water within the system. So you need to have a bipolar plate actually. So through which you are circulating water and the compartment. And you need to pass current, so it should have a current collector. So this is the various component of the PEM-based system, and various international key players are playing major role in developing a PEM-based water electrolysis system. And this, some of them have listed in this table. And as I said, when you produce hydrogen, you need to store it. So if you want to, hydrogen is a lighter gas, so it will occupy more volume. So if you want to store it, it should be compressed. So hydrogen compression, so and it should be compressed at elevated pressures, then only you can reduce the volume for the storage of hydrogen. So the system which are coming in the PEM based system is the hydrogen, when it come from system itself, it get compressed. So you don't want to compress the hydrogen gas externally by adapting some compressor, so which will eliminate the system cost. So you can pressurize the hydrogen within the PEM-based system, and this is the maximum pressures which are available in the commercial market to produce hydrogen at a elevated pressure, and that can be directly stored in the cylinders actually. Just I'm ensuring now the slide is changing. Is it correct? Hello. Yeah.
17 number. We can see 17 number slide.
I'm talking about 19. Is it changing now?
No, sir. So you just make a slide show, sir. Slide show.
The slide show. I'm only doing that. But when you do that, actually taking time, I think.
Okay. So, yes, sir. It is showing, sir. Now 18 number is shown.
It's now I am discussing about 18.
Okay. Yeah.
Now is it visible?
18 number. Slide number 18.
Yeah. So these are the various international manufacturer in the PEM based technology for water electrolysis. And now it is slide number 19. Is it visible now?
No, sir. No.
Oh.
Now it is visible.
Yeah. So when you talk about this hydrogen generation through electrolysis at high temperature, so that is solid oxide water electrolysis. As I said, it's ceramic materials is being used for anode and cathode and separator. So if you want to carry out this electrolysis and process at high temperature, the oxide ion conduction has to be carried out at high temperature. So you need to use only ceramic based materials. Because of the material limitations and availability, this technology is not taking up further. It's only in the R&D level. So far I have talked about hydrogen from the water based source. So apart from the water, you can also produce hydrogen as a byproduct when you do brain electrolysis. So when you do brain water electrolysis, NaCl plus water will produce sodium hydroxide. It's a very good product for the chemical industries, and chlorine gas and addition with hydrogen. So this byproduct hydrogen is currently used for the fuel cell applications in our centers. And in India, about 31 chloroalkali industries are available. So they are producing about the metric ton, about 3000 lakhs metric ton annually, which corresponds to 8643 meter cube of hydrogen. So maximum hydrogen is being utilized, and now the hydrogen utilization which are producing from this chloroalkali process is used for various chemical industries and metallurgical industries, and for nuclear reactors for cooling purpose. So as I said, hydrogen can be produced by electrolysis of water with high energy intensive, and we can produce hydrogen by photolysis, that is called direct sunlight. Using sunlight, we can split the water molecule into hydrogen and oxygen, but the sun has enough energy to split the water molecule. And but unfortunately, the water is transparent. It does not absorb any sun energy. So we need to have some material which will mediate this, which will absorb the sun energy and convert into hydrogen and oxygen. So that is called photolysis. So the selection of material to convert that sun energy into hydrogen and oxygen is crucial, because the material which are available should be stable in both water, and it should conductivity wise it should be high, because the photon has to be converted into electron. Obviously the material conductivity is also playing a major role. So that is the challenge for the photoelectrolysis process. So far we have talked about generations. So when you generate hydrogen from methane reformations or electrolysis process, you need to store hydrogen as a gaseous form or liquid form as solid form. So this hydrogen can be stored in three different forms. One is solid form in terms of metal hydrides, and liquid form, cryogenic hydrogen, and gaseous form at high pressure. So these are the three ways to store the hydrogen. So if you want to store hydrogen at very high pressure, because it's a lighter gas, so you need to compress the gas to some elevated pressure. But at the same time, if you store this hydrogen in a metallic cylinders, so the hydrogen has the tendency to diffuse into the metal lattice. It will create kind of embrittlement on the metal matrix that leads to explosions. So when you want to store hydrogen at elevated pressure, the selection of cylinders material is crucial. So currently, the commercially existing hydrogen cylinders are steel-based cylinders which can withstand up to 150 bar pressure. When you want to store hydrogen at elevated pressure, because if you say, for example, if you take hydrogen in the form of cylinders, and if you put a fuel cell in the vehicle, you need to supply hydrogen as a fuel to the fuel cell. So you need to carry more number of cylinders. So that will increase the weight of the vehicle. So to reduce the weight of a vehicle, you need to store less number of hydrogen cylinders. When you load less number of cylinders, the mileage of the vehicle will come down. So in that case, we have to store the hydrogen at elevated pressure so that the number of cylinders can be reduced for the boarding. So in order to reduce the number of cylinders, you need to store at high pressure. So as I said, hydrogen has a nature of embrittlement to the metal. So you need to choose some other alternative material to store hydrogen at elevated pressure, say for example 350 bar or 700 bar. So for that, we need to go for carbon-based cylinders, carbon composite cylinders, which will withstand high pressure and which will also avoid the hydrogen embrittlement process. So that is the when you do storage of say hydrogen at elevated pressure, so you can carry less number of hydrogen cylinders in the onboard. So that is one form of storing hydrogen at elevated pressure in the form of gas. The next is liquid hydrogen. So that is called cryogenic hydrogen. The amount of energy which we need to spend to liquefy the hydrogen is more than the amount of energy which you need to produce hydrogen. So when you see this energy balance, it is not economical way of storing hydrogen in the liquid form for the transport application. It's only required only for the niche area and especially for the space and all those applications is required only for the liquefied hydrogen, because it's highly energy intensive process if you want to liquefy the hydrogen and store it. And the third one is it's a form of solid, because the hydrogen has a tendency to combine with metal, especially nickel. It's called nickel hydride or metal hydride. So you need to store hydrogen in the metal matrix at elevated pressure and temperature. When you give that pressure and temperature, it get absorbed on the metal surface by physics reactions, and when you apply same pressure and temperature, it will get released. So that is one of the way of storing hydrogen in the solid form, that is called metal hydride. So the hydrogen can be stored in three different form: gaseous, liquid and solid. So as I said, this metal so you need to store, and the Department of Energy USA has set the target. So if you have a material, how much amount of hydrogen it can be accommodated. So if you have a material and if you can store hydrogen about 6 weight percentage, say for example you have 100 grams of material, solid material, and if you under pressure and temperature, if you store 6 gram of hydrogen, then the material is good for the practical applications. So in that case, the carbon nanotubes and carbon nanoscale and other novel materials are people are trying to develop to store to accommodate 6 weight percentage of hydrogen. So in this context, we are also working on material development, especially for the carbon-based material, because carbon has high porous. So if you have a high cellulose content sheets, that can be converted into high porous, high surface area carbon, and low pressure and near ambient pressure and temperature, you can store hydrogen in the porous material. And whenever you require, you apply same pressure and temperature to release hydrogen from the carbon materials. So that is the advantage when you go with a carbon-based material, and which can accommodate up to 6 weight percentage of hydrogen actually. So far we talked about hydrogen generation and storage. Now we are going to come to fuel cell, that is a utilization device. So you have generated hydrogen and you stored hydrogen. Now we are going to use it hydrogen in a fuel cell. So as I say, hydrogen is a very good fuel. It has high energy density. Why do you want to go this route through fuel cell? Because you have a fuel, no? So you can, hydrogen can be utilized in IC engine directly instead of this fossil fuel injection. But when you do such kind of, and you have the air in the atmosphere, when you do such kind of conversion of hydrogen in the IC engine, so the efficiency is less. When you do these electrochemical combustions, that is PEM-based technology, PEM fuel cell, the efficiency of the system is about 40 to 50%. So that's why people are preferring hydrogen, converting hydrogen fuel into power through this route is because of the high efficiency. So that is the main thing. If you see this figure, Could you able to view my?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Okay. So this is the PIM-based statement. Yeah, this is the PIM-based technology. What I am saying is, as I said, this is similar to the electrolysis system. We have the membrane which will conduct the proton, and both side of the membrane we have coated the catalyst. So once you, now the electrodes and electrolytes are ready, now you have to have a flow field plate, because you need one side you need to supply hydrogen gas, another side you need to supply air. And when this hydrogen gas and air, when it react with the catalyst, it generate proton and electron. So the generated proton migrates through the membrane, and if it reaches the cathode surface, and you have the electrode from the external circuit, and you have the air at the cathode compartment, it will form a water. So you will get a power and water. It's simply reverse of the electrolysis process. In electrolysis process, you are giving power to the electrolysis. Power and water get hydrogen and oxygen. In fuel cell, you give hydrogen and oxygen or hydrogen and air, you will get power and water. It's a simply reverse of the electrolysis process. So the system configuration is similar to the PEM water electrolysis. You need to have an anode, you need to have a cathode, you need to have a proton exchange membrane. And in order to facilitate the transport of a reactant like hydrogen and air, you need to have a channel. So that channel is being taken on the graphite plate, which is being called as the flow field plate actually. So it's a graphite based material. So that facilitate the your hydrogen oxygen reaching to the catalyst surface. So in our center, actually, the main difference in electrolysis and this fuel cell is that in electrolysis, you need to spend minimum 1.5 volt actually to do electrolysis. But if you ask the same question, if you give hydrogen and oxygen to the fuel cell, the open circuit potential should be 1.5. Is it correct or not? But we will not get 1.5 volt. We will get around 1 to 1.2 if your system is good. And when you moment, you draw the current. It's like a battery. You are getting open circuit potential of 1 to 1.2 volt. And once you moment draw the load, the voltage will come down. The operating voltage will be around 0.5 to 0.6 volt. You are getting 1 to 1.2 volt as open circuit potential, and operating at 0.6, the efficiency of the system is 50%. But if you combine with the electrolysis process, there you are giving 1.5 volt, okay, and getting hydrogen. So 1.5 and 0.6, the round trip efficiency, because you are giving 1.5, but in practical case, you are getting 2 volt you have to give. So 2 volt you are giving, you are getting back is 0.6 volt. So the efficiency when compared with electrolysis and fuel cell is only 30%. So, but when you talk about only fuel cell efficiency, you are getting 1.2 volt. In this, you are drawing 0.6 volt. So 50% efficiency. And so that is the energy balance which we need to consider when you talk about this PEM-based technology. And our main development in this field is that graphite plates currently, which are widely used in various stack fabrications. So we have used exfoliated graphite plates, which are lower density than the graphite, so which will reduce the cell and stack weight. Actually, that is the novelty of our PMMC technology. And we have developed a system of 1, 2, 3, 5 up to 20 kilowatt, which was demonstrated as a stationary applications. And for the transport applications also, so we have integrated with a battery source, so it can be acted as a range extender. So whenever the power is required for the battery as well as for the running the vehicles, it will support. So we have demonstrated 1 to 5 kilowatt capacity as a range extender with a lead acid battery for various applications actually. And as I said, whatever the system which we developed actually, we are going to put wherever the hydrogen fuel is available. So we have done various field trials in Tamil Nadu as well as in Delhi Gas Authority of India Limited and Neyveli Lignite Corporations. So they have plenty of hydrogen for their purpose, and we use that hydrogen to power the fuels, our fuel cell, that was demonstrated recently in various sectors. And these are our latest development on stationary and the forklift coupling, because the forklift vehicles is required for the carrying the load from one place to another place within the industry. So now the people are looking for instead of diesel operated and battery operated vehicles, people are putting fuel cell as a power source to run the forklift. So we also try to develop a system for the forklift applications. And as I said, the Bhabha Atomic Research Centers, so they have the hydrogen as a coolant for their nuclear reactors. So that hydrogen they want to place for the fuel cell also. Recently we did demonstration with our 5 kilowatt system for the stationary applications. And as I said, we also did demonstration for the in Tamil Nadu government because it's a grid independent actually. We don't want to, if you have hydrogen cylinders, you will get a power. So it should be useful for the emergency relief center for the disaster management. So if you have a disaster kind of situations, if you don't want to grid the depend on the grid, so if you have hydrogen cylinders, so you could able to power some small units up to 5 kilowatt or 10 kilowatt capacity. So that with that objective, we demonstrated with the Tamil Nadu government recently. And as I said, most of the steps which are involved in the PMFC technology development are semi-automated right now in our facilities. We try to make it fully automation with a robotic help. So currently we are in the way of developing a PMFC pilot plant assembly to complete manufacturing the fuel cells of 100 kilowatt per year capacity. So currently that is undergoing in our centers. As I said, we are also working on generation aspects, hydrogen generation. As I said, the amount of energy which we need to spend for the water electrolysis, about 5 units of electricity, and with that 1 meter cube of hydrogen, we will produce 1 kilowatt power. We try to minimize this energy gap by using methanol water electrolysis, where you can reduce the power consumption for hydrogen production. In this process, you can produce hydrogen is about 1 to 1.5 kilowatt power. So giving 1 to 1.5 kilowatt power to produce hydrogen, that hydrogen, with that hydrogen in fuel cell, you can deliver 1 to 1.2 kilowatt. So now we try to reduce the amount of energy which we need to spend on hydrogen production and amount of energy which we are getting from the hydrogen. So with that objective, we demonstrated up to 2.5 meter cube per hour, normal meter cube per hour capacity, methanol based. We are doing reforming of methanol electrochemically in a PEM based system. So if you see this, so far this PMFC technology, especially in India, is being used for the telecom backup power applications, because the telecom tower, which is being, it is grid connected. So whenever the grid power is get failure, you need to have your own power. In most of the telecom telecom towers, that is being powered by diesel genset. So now people are trying to replace the diesel, instead of diesel genset, fuel cell. So for that, the idea and the Reliance, because the idea is Aditya Birla Group, so they have a huge amount of hydrogen source. So they want to utilize that hydrogen through fuel cell to power the telecom tower up to 3 to 5 kilowatt capacity as a backup power for the telecom. So that is the current usage for fuel cell in India. And in internationally, various demonstration and various fuel cell vehicles are available, especially the Toyota Mirai and Hyundai Tescon and Honda Clarity, which are completely fuel cell based vehicles. And so they have an infrastructure for hydrogen filling. And so it's a commercially available hydrogen based fuel cell vehicle. And though globally it has been demonstrated for stationary and transport applications, there are some more challenges. Only the cost and durability. So these are the two challenges that are lying, cost and durability. So the durability, so far it has been tested for 5,000 hours in transport application and 40,000 hours tested for the stationary applications. So people are trying to increase the lifetime of the fuel cell, so that though if you're ready to invest and reduce the cost. the cost and durability. These are the main challenges which are existing in fuel cell technological development. And as I said, it's a basically hydrogen is energy storage medium, battery is also energy storage medium. So when you compare these two different energy storage medium, which one is better? So if you answer that question, actually, as I said, the battery, the amount is a net energy analysis, energy stored on investment, invested actually. So that is the term. So in the what is the it is defined as the ratio between the amount of energy which are getting back from the device and the amount of energy to manufacture the device. So that is the ratio between this ratio will give you the energy stored on investment. If you take the lithium battery, if you want to develop a 1 kilowatt lithium battery, you need to spend almost some amount of energy. So once if you manufacture this 1 kilowatt lithium ion battery and use it for your application, it's undergo various charging discharging process. So over life period. So if say for example, the life period of the battery is 1 year, and every day, if it's spending about 1 kilowatt power, so it's delivering 360 kilowatt hour power in a year. But the amount of energy which we need to spend to fabricate 1 kilowatt lithium ion battery, and if you consider this ratio, energy stored on investment for lithium ion battery is 35 ESOI. Whereas in the fuel cell and electrolysis, because it's basically reverse of the fuel cell is electrolysis, you need to spend, you don't want to spend more energy to produce fuel cell or PMM water electrolysis cell. So in that case, the energy stored on investment is high when compared with battery, but the efficiency eta star, so that is called round trip efficiency. In electrolysis, you have to spend 2 volt. In fuel cell, you are getting back only 0.6 volt. That is 30%. That is 0.3. Whereas in the battery, the charging, you have to charge the battery up to 1.5 to 1.2 kilowatt. Okay. And you can get back 1 kilowatt. So the efficiency of the battery is more right now. So now that's why people are trying to reduce the gap. The amount of energy which we need to spend to generate hydrogen should be less. Or if you increase the fuel cell efficiency, this 0.3 may become 0.5 or 0.6. So in that case, it is commercially viable to store renewable energy in the form of hydrogen. So that is the main point which I want to insist on that particular aspects. So considering the importance of the hydrogen in the future, Department of Energy USA is celebrating 8th October every year as a hydrogen fuel cell day, representing its atomic weight 1.0088. 10th October 8th is considered as a hydrogen fuel cell day, and we are also celebrating each year so hydrogen fuel cell day by conducting various workshops and seminar. So last 2 years we have conducted, this year also we have planned to conduct on October 8th. So as I said, we talk about hydrogen, so we need to long way to go if you want to realize this technology for the commercial purpose. So what are the things which we need to be done is that there are minimum groups are working on the system development. So there are many groups are working on materials and development, but nobody is working on the system development. So we need to work, more people has to be working on system development and the manufacturing, because making one or two unit is cost compulsive process. So we need to manufacture in a large quantity. So for that, it required various manufacturing facilities is required. Before, if you want to implement the fuel cell, you need to have a hydrogen generations. So we need to have a hydrogen generation technology and its corresponding infrastructure. So which we need to develop, like a hydrogen filling stations, like our petrol pump, we must have a hydrogen filling station if you want to use hydrogen powered vehicles. So that kind of infrastructure is also required. As I said, we are in the peak of oil based or fossil fuel based scenario. So definitely we need to move towards hydrogen. So it takes some time, but ultimately the hydrogen fuel cell will be the alternative energy source. As I said, we cannot completely eliminate carbon. So we need to live with the carbon. Currently, we are living with more carbon. So in future, we need to try to reduce less carbon and more hydrogen. So with that end note, I am thank for your kind attention, and I'm most welcome for any kind of your questions.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Nice presentation. PM fuel cell technology. Participants, if any question, without hesitation, you can ask. Sir, Dr. Rakesh Srivastava, sir, is joining with us. Srivastava, sir. Hello.
Yeah.
I think sir is not audible. Okay. Participants, any question? Students, any question from your side, you can ask without hesitation. Many faculties also with joining with us.
Sure.
Yeah. So any now the forum is open for all. So without wasting time, we can interact. So start again, sir. Hello.
Yeah, sir. Yeah.
Sir, please.
Yeah. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
I want some my queries. I have already listed out in your presentation. So can I ask some queries to you, sir?
Please.
Yeah. I want to ask. You have your own facility for membrane manufacturing, sir?
Right now we are not facilities. Existing facilities for manufacturing membrane. Currently we are using commercially available Navian membrane for our stack development.
Okay, miss, you are directly focusing on the ready document membrane available in the market.
Yeah.
Okay. Second thing, sir, in your slide number 33, you have shown some appliances or demo kit for polymer electrolyte membrane fuel cell. Okay. So you already operated some instrument or some kind of appliances on the.
Yeah. So we have demonstrated for all the DC powered fan, AC, refrigerator, and motors, bulb. So we have demonstrated this fuel cell for the commercial load, like whatever listed, it has also been used in the motors with a battery as a range extender for the transport applications.
Okay. So that means this is basically operated on the basis operated with a fuel cell stack, right?
Yeah, system. Yeah.
Okay. So in terms of cost, sir, it is feasible. Suppose if I want to operate a fan with this PMFC cell,
yeah.
So what will be the probable cost for that stack?
Actually, sir, the cost, if I say, that would be the real cost, because the cost will, because it's R&D cost. So yeah, if you come to manufacturing, definitely there may be some difference in that actually. Manufacturing that stack, if the market, if the demand is more, still it will come down. So right now, based on the R&D expertise and the material availability, you can use about 2.5 to 3 lakhs per kilowatt.
Correct.
So that is the current R&D cost. So that easily can bring down when you increase the number of, demand if it increases and manufacturabilities are there, then we can considerably reduce the cost up to 1 to 1.5 lakhs per kilowatt.
Okay. So currently we are working with PMFC direct liquid fuel cell with ethanol as a fuel.
Okay, fine. Okay.
Yeah, we are working with the different fuel cell concentration, the operating temperature and other parameters.
Okay.
So apart from this, I just request you please suggest some alternative fuels which will called as a future fuels for this PMFC fuel cells.
If you take methanol or ethanol, the main challenge is that the hydrogen, which does not contain any carbon. If you go with the methanol, you are introducing one carbon, so the hydrogen has to come out from that hydrocarbon first. In the case of ethanol, you are going with two carbon, so the carbon-carbon bond is there, no? So to break carbon-carbon bond, it's required more energy and more catalyst, actually, high efficient catalyst. So beyond that, we can use isopropyl alcohol. There's a 3-carbon alcohols, actually. So basically, if you try to increase the carbon content in the fuel, okay, the energy density of the fuel cell will come down. So basically, you need to have a fuel processor. So you get the hydrogen from the ethanol, then use it in fuel cell, that efficiency will go up. So instead of using methanol or ethanol directly in the fuel cell system, you get the hydrogen from those sources with the external fuel processor and use it in fuel cell, you will get more energy than is combined in situ way of doing that.
So basically, we are working with passive type of fuel cell.
Yeah, I agree that.
Yeah, so due to limitations of resources, we are focusing on passive kind of system. So that's why other equipments like fuel cell testers are not available with us.
In that case, if you try to identify a good electrolyte catalyst with ethanol or methanol, then you can increase the efficiency of the system.
Okay, sir. Okay. The last question. So, as per your view, as per your research, what are the probable fuel cells we have to consider for future for coming research?
The low temperature fuel cell.
Yeah,
it's viable for the stationary application. I mean, transport as well as stationary application.
Correct.
What I am talking about that if you want to really implement this fuel cell for the real applications. It's a multidisciplinary field actually, fuel cell.
So
if you develop a 1 kilowatt system, it's basically the fuel cell will produce DC power. So and if you want to use it directly DC power, you need to have a DC appliances in the home. So that currently we don't have actually. So we need to develop an inverter to convert the DC into AC. Hello. Yeah.
Yeah.
You need to convert DC into AC. So, and you need to have a inverter. So, whatever the commercially available inverters, which is meant for the battery, may not be suitable for the fuel cell, because the fuel cell is being operated lower voltage and higher current, whereas battery is operating at higher voltage and lower current. So, the entire electronics are different actually. So, what I'm suggesting that instead of focusing developing a fuel cell system, if we try to develop other BOP components like inverters and hydrogen supply system, air supply system, say for example, if you're developing 1 kilowatt fuel cell system, the parasitic loss for the air supply system, the hydrogen supply system, cooling system, so all those things is consume high energy, high power. So if you develop a 1 kilowatt system, you need to spend only 100 watts for the BOP components actually. So that kind of components which are not available for the Indian market. So if you try to develop a low power components, BOP components for the fuel cell, that will add value to the fuel cell system. So that kind of area, as an engineering faculty, if you try to address that kind of issue, definitely it has a big impact on technological penetration sector.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Srivastava sir.
Hello,
yeah.
Balaji sir. Yeah, Balaji sir. It was a wonderful session, sir. Thank you so much for giving a lot of insights into your research. Maybe we'll be in touch with you and we'll learn more and more things from your expertise. And as you have rightly suggested, that life systems, if you can come up with rather than going for fuel cells, if you can get other commercial applications, support systems this, we'll try to focus now on those support.
I feel that engineering faculty can do more because the existing support system, if you try to modify according to the fuel cell, that itself is a good contribution to this community, I think.
Yeah, that will be wonderful. So thank you very much for your suggestion.
Thank you.
Rajesh, kindly note this.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Any other faculty want to interact? Any question from participants, students? Without hesitation, you can ask, interact with sir. Especially those opting towards an elective. No question? Medical sir? Medical sir? Can you hear me, Medical sir? Okay.
Sir, I have one question.
Giri sir, yeah. Please sir.
Yeah. Please, sir. Sir, as far as the utilization of fuel cells and the current trend, research trend which is going on in fuel cells, what are the different opportunities regarding optimization? I mean, the area where we can use optimization algorithms or different optimization techniques?
Optimization in terms of...
Optimization in terms of the improvement in the fuel cells, maybe related to the efficiency of a fuel cells, or maybe with respect to the design aspects of a fuel cells.
As I said, when you see the conversion efficiency, because chemical energy is converted into electrical energy and heat energy. So if you see that energy efficiency of the fuel cell is about 80%. So for example, if you develop a 1 kilowatt fuel cell system, it also develop a 1 kilowatt thermal energy. So almost 80% conversion efficiency for fuel cell. 50% will be electrical, 50% will be thermal. So you need to have only disadvantage that the thermal energy is there, it's a low grade heat. So that cannot be used for any high temperature applications, that only meant for the room heating purpose actually. So our water heating purpose. So if you have an effective system to use that heat as a source for converting into water heater or some kind of room heating purpose, so ultimately efficiency of the system will go up. It's a combined heat and power, CHP.
Okay.
So if you try to concentrate on that aspect, the entire system value will increase apart from the electrical efficiency. So, I mean, I feel the efficiency of the system may not go beyond 50 to 55% actually. So what I'm trying to use that thermal energy, if you use it for this kind of applications, I think that add value to the system actually. And second thing is in terms of electrical efficiency, system compactness. So that is also one of the factors for the increasing the efficiency. So instead of the graphite-based system currently, which are people are using, people are trying to use a metallic-based system. So that will reduce the system, increase the system compactness, that also increase the efficiency of the system. So I think that thermal energy has to be utilized in an effective way. So that is the only way to increase the efficiency of, overall efficiency of the fuel cell.
Okay. So, sir, is there any, the scope is there regarding the design aspects of the fuel cells regarding this compactness?
Yeah, a lot of scopes are there, especially for the bipolar plate aspects, actually.
Okay.
So, because as I said, if you can use a thin foil, a corrugated foil as a flow feed plate, so that will reduce the space for the fuel cell. So, say for example, if you develop a 1 kilowatt system with a graphite base and it is occupying 0.6 meter cube of volume, and if you use that metallic plate with a thin metallic plate, it can 50% reduction in the volume will save you the space actually. So that is the design of the fuel cells playing a major role in that, bringing the volume of the fuel cell stack to some extent.
Sir, one last question again. Basically, we are while working on the fuel cells, we know that membrane is really important, the membrane material as well as the overall membrane. But still, we need to buy membrane or need to import the better membrane so that the fuel cells can design in a better way. So, what are the opportunities in India to develop membrane or maybe work in the material side of the membrane?
That is a very good question, actually. So, definitely, really appreciating that question, because as you said, if you want any technology, if you want to make a viable product, especially in India, the 60% of the component will be indigenous.
Yeah.
Okay, any technology if you take. Coming to the fuel cell, the main core component is the membrane electrode assembly.
Right.
So the electrode catalyst, which are platinum based, which can be indigenized. There are resources are available. And, technical feasibilities are there, so that can be indigenized. And the metallic plate, bipolar plate, that can also be indigenized. As you said, the membrane is a monopoly in the world. So there are many R&D programs going on in India. And because we are very sound with membrane science, actually, not with membrane technology.
Okay.
So so those who are working on the polymer, so they try to concentrate, they are trying to concentrate only on the science aspect, not on the technology aspect. Even in our lab, we could develop a very good membranes when compared with Nafion, but that can be done only in a smaller area, less than 0.5 square meter. When you want to make it to higher area, people are facing challenges. People are, first of all, people are not putting attempt to make you, because they are successing with some single cell or some smaller area, and they are happy with that actually. So really, the polymer technologist has to come forward to take that science into technology. So developing a membrane. So that is a very huge gap and very big opportunities lying on that particular aspect. If you have a very good membrane science, and if you want to convert that membrane science into membrane technology, it's a fantastic. So I'm urge you to work on that. If you do develop a membrane science, and you need to figure out right partner as a membrane technologist, and so polymer science has to be converted to polymer technology. So I feel we are have enough knowledge on membrane science, on not on membrane technology. So that is the bottleneck in India. Still we are depending on importing. So if we could develop such kind of approach, definitely this fuel cell makes viable product.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. Thank you for thank the you. Kind reply.
Hello, yeah.
Bodke sir, can you please come up? Is there any question from any other student or maybe from the faculty? Bodke sir? Is there any specific question you would like to ask anybody, student or faculties? Professor Rajesh Bodke, please. Yeah, Chetan, Professor Bodke, please. So is there any question from anybody? Sir is waiting, so that's why I'm asking.
It's okay.
Sir, very good afternoon. This is Dr. Khedkar from, again, the same department, Mechanical Engineering, YCC. I really thankful to you that very explanatory, all presentation is very very clear and explanatory. Sir, my simple query is regarding like what will be the kind of areas which will be considered for the research by the students. Like, for example, students will take kind of UGP project or PG project. So what will be the kind of most suitable area that can be focused by the student in the field of fuel cell?
As a mechanical background student, so I suggest you to concentrate on thermal management of a PM fuel cell system. And second is that balance of plant, developing a compact and less power, less cost consuming BOP components like air blower, hydrogen supply system, and control system for the fuel cells actually. So that would be the right area for the students to work on, the daily instead of working on the PMF system, PMF stack development, the thermal management for the fuel cells, it's a good area to work on that students actually.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
No, sir.
Sir.
Yeah, yeah. You are audible, sir. You are audible.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Yeah. Because it's okay. Yeah. Is it possible? Yeah. So we are also undertaking students for the final year projects actually. So only thing is they must have a minimum 4 months durations. So if they have, then we can take it up. No issues on that aspect. Because of this COVID pandemic issues, currently we are not encouraging to students to take up this year, but maybe next year definitely is it possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Balaji sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.